Today we're going to talk about live baby brine shrimp. Now whether you're trying to condition adults for breeding, feed their fry, or just feed a picky nano fish, live baby brine shrimp are a great addition to your toolbox. And this time I'm going to show you the method I use to hatch fresh batches every day and always keep them available. Okay, here's my brine shrimp hatching station. If this looks really complicated, don't worry, because it's not. It's just a bunch of simple parts. But later on, I am going to show you a way that you can hatch brine shrimp on rotation with a simpler set of equipment that's much less expensive. Let's go over the parts. We have a 2.5-gallon aquarium just to fill up with water. You can see that the hatching vats are partially submerged in it. I use a heater to maintain temperature, so I'm keeping it even between all the vats at exactly the temperature that I want. They have a simple frame made from half-inch PVC, some elbow and T-fittings and caps. This is probably $15, but less than $20 worth of PVC. We have a small air pump. This is just a cheap one. I think it's about 8 watts. It was one of the first air pumps I ever bought, and I don't use it anymore, so it was perfect for this. We have an airline gang valve fitting right here. Also includes check valves. This allows me to control airflow to each of the vats here and turn them off when it's time to drain and sift the brine shrimp. The flow of air through the hatching vat is important to keep the brine shrimp eggs and the hatched brine shrimp from piling up on the bottom, clumping together, and suffocating. Lastly, we have the hatching vats. Now, if these look familiar, it's probably because you've encountered a video including master breeder Dean, who is associated with the aquarium co-op. And it was on his recommendation that I chose to use these essentia water bottles here, mostly because of this cone shape down here. When it comes time to drain and sift the brine shrimp, this angle really helps them to flow down towards the airline fitting and then down the tube rather than getting stuck on the walls. I have the top cut off above where it starts to curve so that it still has some structure, some rigidity. I drilled some holes in the side. We've got little socket cap screws, nuts, holding wire that allows me to hang it. It's simple, but it works. There are a few other factors to consider when trying to create an optimal environment for the brine shrimp to hatch. Primarily temperature, salinity, pH, and light. So we're handling that in a number of ways here. First of all, temperature. You can see that the vats are partially immersed in water, whose temperature I'm regulating with a heater here. It's right at 82 degrees. That's the bottom range of what's recommended to get an optimal hatch rate. pH should be between 8 and 8.5, and that's a challenge for me because my tap water comes out just above neutral, so I have to add a small amount of baking soda to my water to raise the pH. To get the right salinity for the brine shrimp to hatch, it's recommended to use between 1/2 and 2 tablespoons of aquarium salt per liter of water. These vats that you see here are 700 milliliter bottles, but they're not filled all the way. I measured earlier and they're just over 600 milliliters at the level I have them at, so I'm opting to use about 1 tablespoon of aquarium salt per vat. Now, lighting is not often talked about or explained very well. Most of the time you'll see an incandescent light placed near the bottom of a hatching vat and explained as being primarily a heat source because incandescent lights get pretty warm. And that can be a nice and simple way to heat up the vat, but light isn't important for another reason. The brine shrimp cysts are actually photosensitive and a good light source will help to stimulate them into hatching. That's very important for the first few hours, but it's actually beneficial to leave that light source on them for the entire hatching period. I use an LED desk lamp positioned above the setup. You can't really see the light source now. Here, I'll tip it down. There you go. I just leave that on them the whole time. So you might be wondering, why go to all this effort? Why is it so important to have multiple batches going at the same time? Well, I would explain it this way. If you're using brine shrimp as a supplementary live food source for adult fish, you don't have to. Every once in a while, or every 36 hours, if that's how long it takes you to hatch, that's absolutely fine. You probably have some alternative foods to feed them in the meantime. But if you're using this as a primary food source for fish fry, you need it available and you need it fresh all the time, all day, every day. Given that it has a hatch time of between 24 and 36 hours, you can't depend on one batch, use it, and then start another and wait another 24 to 36 hours for the next to hatch. You need food every few hours. And so by having multiple vats going at the same time, I can ensure that every day I have a new batch hatching. And that's where the importance of this heater here and the light comes in. You want to get the hatch time as short as possible. If you can get it down to 24 hours, that means that each morning you can dump an old batch and start a new one, and then know that the next morning it's going to be ready to feed. You might not have the entire batch hatched and ready to go, but you'll have a lot of it. You can drain, sift, and then feed those to your fish. Come back a few hours later and you'll have more. So I'm going to show you real quick how I set up a new batch for myself. I already filled up this vat with water. Need to add a few things here. For this, just over 600 milliliters of water, I'm adding 1 tablespoon of aquarium salt, 1/4 teaspoon of baking soda to raise the pH. Remember, we want between 8 and 8.5. And I'm doing just over 1/2 teaspoon of brine shrimp eggs. The max is 2.5 grams per liter. I measured out what I have here, and this is about 1.5, so being almost 1 liter, this is fine. This is not too dense. And there they go. It's begun. And you might see that the cysts, they tend to stick up on the side there and they have to be brushed down. All I do is, for the first few hours, when I pass by my hatching station, I just kind of give this a little swirl and it knocks them back down. I'll do that quite a bit over the first several hours that it's going, and then they saturate with water and they tend to stay in place longer. But that's ready to go. Tomorrow I'm going to have a great new batch to work with. Now these two on the right have already been going, one of them since first thing this morning and another since yesterday. Now I've already fed from it once. It's not going to be very dense, but I'm still going to turn off the air and let them settle so I can show you how I prepare them to feed. Now, you might have heard other places that the baby brine shrimp are attracted to a light source, and so you might see some kind of a pen light or something pointed at the bottom. Well, I can't really do that here. I can't stick a light down inside the water. But what I've found is they are attracted to light, but if you deprive them of all light, they just fall right to the bottom. The best separation I've ever seen is when it's left to settle in darkness. Now, I can't do that here. This is right in the middle of the living room, but this isn't where I have it. Normally, this is on my bathroom counter, so I just turn off the bathroom light, and then they're in darkness. So I'm going to go ahead and let them settle. Just going to turn off the air. And turn off the light. Might just even cover this in a blanket and come back in a little bit. So I'll see you soon. Okay, so after being allowed to settle for a little bit, you can see the water pretty clear. Not all of them have ended up at the bottom, but that big orange mass right there, that's what we're after. Now we're ready to harvest some brine shrimp. Got a net here. This is not one of those rigid sieves. This is actually flexible. And this is kind of big and clunky, but I actually really like it. And I'll show you why here in just a second. So I'm just going to set this on a cup. Keeps it sturdy. I'm going to pinch and remove the airline tube from vat number 2. And all I do is I just lay that in there. Look at that. That's what you're looking for. I'm just going to let that drain. And you can kind of watch the vat of water. You're going to have a lot that settle all the way to the bottom, but if you still have a little cloud of them floating above it, you can let this drain down for a while and catch quite a few of them. If you have good brine shrimp eggs and they separate well, like these do, see that big mat of brown up there? There's not a lot of eggs floating, so we can allow this to drain down pretty low without worrying about getting a bunch of unhatched eggs in here. For the sake of time, though, I'm going to call this good. I'm just going to pinch it and raise it up so the water flows back out of it. Pinch it again. Put it back in place. I'm going to turn the air back on. Keep those brine shrimp alive in there. Because I'm going to use those later in the evening. Okay, so now we rinse. I am a fan of rinsing. Whatever waste produced or junk that there might be in that vat, I don't want that to get into the aquarium. I'm also not a fan of the salt. I use plants in every tank, and so I don't want anything threatening their health. So I'm going to rinse this, and I normally do this over a sink because this station is in the bathroom, but right now I just have some water in a bottle. Now this happens to be dechlorinated, but it doesn't need to be. Rinsing them is not enough exposure for the chlorine to really hurt them. I don't know if I mentioned either, the water in these vats is not dechlorinated. It doesn't need to be. It's going to break down. Okay, so actually I'll use this same container here. I'm just going to give this a rinse, and this would just be under the sink. Rinse off all that junk. And so to actually feed, I use a small container. Get some water in it. It's usually just tank water, honestly. I put some in there. And the reason I love this loose net is that I can just grab this, turn it upside down, and dunk it in there a bit. Okay, we got all those out. And now we have a nice concentrated collection of shrimp right there that we can take a pipette to and remove and then portion out and feed to our fish. By the way, one additional note, you can easily portion what size of a batch you want to make for your fish. Maybe you don't have a lot and you just need a few. You can do much less than half a teaspoon. You can do a quarter, even less than that. But if you do end up with a batch that's larger than what you need, a great thing to do is you can take these and put them into a mini ice cube tray and freeze them. And you can make your own supply of frozen baby brine shrimp. You can have those for emergencies, or maybe you're just a fan of frozen only. You don't want to be hatching these on a daily basis, and you have adult fish that don't need them to be alive. That's absolutely fine. You can still hatch a big, dense batch of these every once in a while and then just freeze them and have them available all the time. I have some in my freezer right now. If you don't want to freeze the excess, but you happen to pull a little more than you wanted and you need some more for later in the evening, don't worry, you can just put them back into the vat, adding a little bit more unsalty water is not going to change the salinity in this enough to bother anything. So you can have those for later. I'm going to clean this up, put it back where it came from, and then I'm going to show you a really simple way to do this same thing with much less equipment. See you soon. Okay, we're back with the cheap and simple version. So this right here is a San Francisco Bay brand brine shrimp hatchery. These are really simple, really cheap, probably $12 to $15 a piece. They hide and attach the airline tubing on the underside there. So if you just have one of these, if this is as far as you want to go in terms of buying equipment, not including the air pump, you're still going to need an air pump for this and some kind of a gang valve or a splitter. But if this is all the time and energy you want to put into brine shrimp, you can work with this. What you need to do is have them hatching somewhere else and then move them into here when it's time. So you can have one batch in here, hatched, harvested, ready to dump. You just keep a bottle off to the side, maybe two, run some airline tubing down to the bottom. You can still aerate and keep this churning and have a batch hatching in here. And then after this is dumped and cleaned, you just take what's in here, dump it in here, and you've got a fresh batch. So before I built the system I just showed you, I used to use this. One of these, and then one or two bottles off to the side, ready to put into here when the time comes. I think if you were doing it this method, without additional heat, without consistent light, you can count on that hatch time being at least 36 hours, so having three different vats going would be helpful to make sure you have them every day. So this is there. This is an option if you want to use it. It's way better than nothing. Believe me, brine shrimp are worth it. So I hope one of these two methods can be of some help to you. And again, thanks for watching. Bye.